Gabriel Nassif, aka Yellow Hat, and I'm gonna be sharing with you the two decks I'm considering for my regional championship this weekend in just a few days. You can see some of the other decks I've been trying out on Arena, but the two decks I'm considering are Blue-White Control and Teemer Ramp Nissa combo. So gonna go over these two decks, give you a kind of a detailed deck guide, and play probably like a match with each, maybe a couple match if the matches are not the best. So first off is my current list for Blue-White Control. It's pretty similar to the list I played at the Pro Tour, and I was definitely really excited about this deck. After the PT, it did really well. I thought it was really well positioned. I thought it had a really good matchup against Domain and a decent Boros Convoke matchup, as well as a close but fine Esper matchup, which were the most played decks at the PT. I think the meta has shifted a little bit, and people's lists and deck choices in general have gotten a little more hateful towards Blue-White Control, so I'm not as confident as I was a few weeks ago, but it's still a deck I'm strongly considering. So yeah, I'll go over the list. You've got your counter spells with Three Steps Ahead and No More Lies. Think these are pretty set in stone, as well as the card advantage engine with four deduce and four memory deluge. I think maybe trimming one deduce is acceptable. Not a really powerful card, and one of the reasons to play Blue-White Control in general, and Blue-White over Blue-Black Control, for instance, is the Wandering Emperor. Four copies, just super versatile, proactive removal, really strong card, obviously. Then you have your Sweepers package. You've got two Lockdowns, one Depauperate, two Sunsoul, one Farewell. At the PT, I had eight Sweepers total. I'm down to six. Decided to fit in a couple Tide Miners in the main over more Sweepers. I think six is still good. They're good in most matchups, even against a deck like Domain. It's actually the way you win game one. You just keep sweeping their board every time they play a hard Migration or an Atraxa, just kill all their threats and kind of deck them with Jace usually. So yeah, six Sweepers. You could play one more, you could play one less. But I like that makes that number. And I think the one Farewell is kind of nice. It comes up against some enchantments like Binding sometimes, or against Boros. They could have the Anthem that's annoying. Against the Teemer lands deck, that's one of the wins. One of the ways you can slow them down and win game one is get their graveyard, maybe add a creature or green virtue in the process, so that can come in handy as well. After that, you've got the spot removal, to get lost to March. This is probably, I would say most lists have more spot removal, but I don't want to play too many. I'd rather have more sweepers. I used to play Destroy Evil. I think Destroy Evil was pretty good back when you expected a lot of Esper midrange because it hits Preacher, it hits Rafine, it hits Wedding Announcements. But the meta has shifted. There's less Esper, there's more decks like Teemer Ramp, there's more control, and Destroy Evil doesn't do much. It doesn't kill any of the Teemer creatures. It's not very good in the mirror. And Get Lost, which is not a card I love. I don't love giving, that much value to my opponents and these resources, but I feel like it's a necessary evil, and the card has grown on me. So to Get Lost to March, you have one Jace, which is kind of a bit of a luxury card in some ways. I think you could beat Domain game one without it and just deal with the entire deck, but it does make it a little easier. It does save you time in paper too. If your opponent's not scooping, that can be valuable. It's a fine card in general. Sometimes it's clunky, but it can take over. Even against really aggressive decks like Mono Red, I've had that card take over where I traded it early on with their threats, and then Jace just got me the card advantage I needed. It lines up really well against a card like Glissa. Black Green Midrange has been a little more popular. It has its moments. It's really good in the mirror. It's kind of a must counter in the mirror, which is always nice. And finally, two Timebinder in the main. I used to just have them all in the sideboard, but as I said, I've cut sweepers. I fit some Timebinder in the main, which freed up some slots in the sideboard, which is a nice bonus. And it's a card that, even though your opponent's going to have a bunch of dead removal in hand in game one, the effect is still useful. It's nice against Domain, against Atraxa, against Recruiter. It's really, really solid against Convoke and almost never dead. It can be a pain in the mirror, and it can help you fight in game one against Team or Lance, which has been really popular. It could maybe even be the most played deck this weekend in some RCs. Or I definitely expect Team or Lance to be at least top three, maybe top two decks played this weekend. So yeah, that's for the spells, the main deck. The mana base is also up for debate. I think I like four Field of Ruins for Anchorage, for Deserted Beach, the Autoaura, the Igancho. At least two or three Seachrome Coast, one Outer Car Waste, one Archive. Some people play Myrex. Myrex was pretty bad, I think, for the Pro Tour metagame. I think it's a bit better now. And some people also play Sunken Citadel. I would not play Sunken Citadel unless I played Myrex, because if Sunken Citadel is good, it means that you have Anchorage, which means you play two coming to play tap lands in the early turns of the game. And that's something you really want to avoid. You really want to be able to play No More Lies, Deduce on two. So I think if you play 28 lands, I'm playing 27. If you go up to 28, I think it's reasonable to try and fit one Myrex, one Sunken Citadel. And yeah, the flex slots, as far as I'm concerned, or maybe that Archive could be another Seachrome Coast or a second Outer Car Waste. But I kind of like this mana base in general. As far as sideboard goes, let's go one by one. Rest in peace, mostly for Team Orleans and the Legends deck, which is a tough matchup as well. You could play a second one, even though they can remove it a lot of time against the lands deck. Just the trigger, the damage might be done. You know, you get rid of their first batch of lands, and that slows them down a lot. And even if they get rid of it with a Pick Your Poison, that actually happened to me twice in the Pro Tour where I played it, Exile the Graveyard. They got rid of it, but I was just fine with it. I slowed him down, and I even got to cast my own Delusion, flash him back. So I like one rest in peace. Negate is kind of versatile, comes in a lot of matchups, typically against control, but you can even bring it in against Esper Midrange if you know they have a lot of, if they're on the Wedding Announcement build, for instance. You can maybe bring it against Mono Red to counter an Urbrass Forge. So yeah, in general, one thing that happens with this list is that because Tidebinder is so versatile and comes in pretty much every matchup, you're kind of almost always going to have too many cards to bring in. So it's going to be a little tricky to sideboard at times. You're going to have too many cards to bring in and maybe not enough cards to board out. So yeah, what I do sometimes is I just cut some expensive cards, like I'll trim a Wandering Emperor or three steps ahead sometimes in a matchup like Esper maybe. Just to lower my curve a tiny bit. Knockout Blow, just great against red. A lot of the games you lose against red is to the Forge, so you don't want to go too crazy on the knockout blows, but I mean, you'll still play as many as you can fit. Two more lockdowns. Classic Arena UI is just splitting the lockdowns, but yeah. For mono red and Convoke mostly, if you get paired against Infect. Just it's nice to be able to go up to four lockdowns. Same for Tidebinder. Comes in pretty much every matchup. Control, Convoke, Mono Red for the Forge, Domain. So you know, you could even play maybe more in the main. I think maybe one or two is fine because it can be a little clunky and awkward, but you have to sideboard it's nice. That kind of card, like you board out the cards that are bad in the matchup and you bring in Tidebinders because they're always going to be decent. Alexstrasza is mostly for the Team Orleans deck, stops almost every card in their deck. It's nice against Domain. I also bring it in against Convoke and Mono Red, kind of adjust a Fred that takes over the board. It stops a lot of the Convoke triggers and just huge blocker. And kind of the same thing against Fred. The reasoning is that it helps you fight Forge, you know, as long as the Forge doesn't get totally out of control, it means it can block the Forge token for a while, stop some of their coming to plays. And I think I'd rather have that card than maybe another sweeper. So yeah, what I'll do against Shred is I'll board out every sweeper that's not locked down and bring in my creatures. Two flankers, I really like this card. I'm bringing it against the red decks, and I'm bringing it against the lands deck as well. I'm bringing it in the control mirror just as a flash threat. Sometimes you get to exile a Memory Deluge, or the gain two life to scry two is nice as well. So flexible, really nice card. Sea Devil is mostly for Domain, for Atraxa. I think the matchup is fine and you don't really need it, but it is a nice little boost and it can also speed up the game. The Domain matchup can be quite slow, and having the Jace in the main and that Sea Devil that can maybe hopefully copy an Atraxa can kind of speed up your wins, your games, especially if somehow you lose game one, which shouldn't happen, but you never know. You can also bring it in, especially in open deck lists in the mirror. If you see they have Heartbreaker Horror, bring it in. If against Temur Lands, I've seen Temur Lands play Horror as well, and they'll probably bring in their own threats like Roxane and Bonnie Paul. So I would probably bring it in that matchup as well. And I've even brought it in against Black Green Midrange, but I'm not so sure about that one. And the Bela, speaking of Black Green Midrange, pretty much for these Lily Investigator decks, this is untested, but I think it makes sense. That matchup's been tough and a little more popular, and the versions of green black midrange have become more and more hateful. Just the black midrange deck in general have become more and more hateful towards the control decks, with more Lilianas in the main and the sideboard, more hostile investigators. So I think that card makes sense. If it was just Lily, I feel like it would be maybe a little narrow, but if they have a lot of time, they'll have up to four Lily and up to three or four Investigator. So what are they gonna do? Just not cast these cards, not plus Lily. So I think that might be the answer to that matchup, which can be quite tough. Valkyrie, this is just against the aggressive decks, Mono Red Convoke. If they'll show up, it's a 4/4 flying that backs up. So pretty self-explanatory, and then no, it doesn't want. And then Heartbreaker Horror, 7/8 uncountable. Great in control mirrors and potentially good against the lands deck. I would probably bring it against the lands deck. I would not bring it against Domain. In general, don't bring it in against someone who has Leyline Binding in their deck. It's pretty poor against Leyline Binding. So, yeah. So, yeah, this is the sideboard, current sideboard. I'll give you the like slot 16 through 18. Let's say you had 18 sideboard cards. What would I try to fit in that sideboard? I think one or two more knockout blows. The red matchup's kind of tough. And sure, Forge is one of their scariest cards, maybe their scariest cards. The Planeswalker can be a little scary, but you know, sometimes it can just kill you as the cheap creatures too, and knockout blow buys a lot of time. So that's an option. I think second negate is kind of overkill, same for second Rest in Peace. Second Elesh Norn, if you really expect a lot of the lands deck, but as is, I already have too many cards to bring in against the lands deck. So I had to at some point. I'm back down to one. In Sea Devil is another one. If somehow you know your meta is like gonna be ton of domain for some reason, you know, you could always play a second Haymaker, a second Sea Devil. Same for Bela. You know, all these cards you could play more of. And the one card I've been playing with that's not in this sideboard is Dust Animus, that the 2/3 flying that has plod that comes out of the 4/5 flying lifelink. So that's also a reasonable one of. So, you know, for the RC, if I decide I don't want the Baelos, for instance, I could see myself cutting these two Baelos, adding a second knockout blow and a Dust Animus if I think there's going to be way more mono red than there's going to be black green midrange. So yeah, these are the cards I might consider. Yeah, and the The sideboarding is somewhat straightforward, you know, board out the bad cards, bring in the Tidebinders and the cards that are good. Yeah, I feel like it's mostly you know, the sweepers are gonna come out in a lot of matchups like the mirror or the lands deck. And then I guess boarding out the sweepers against something like Mono Red is maybe not super intuitive, but you have your own creatures and Lockdown kind of deals with the early stuff, so it's kind of a nice synergy. The Jace I'll board out in a lot of matchups. Like for instance against Domain, I don't mind boarding it out even though it's nice in game one. I feel like in game two the games are a little different. They also have negates so they can you know, you maybe don't want to tap out for it. And as for Mage Range, I would probably just not board too many cards. There's just not much you can do against Esper Mage Range. If they're on the play, they have a good draw. Doesn't really matter what you have in your sideboard. I'll maybe bring in a third Tidebinder and a negate and maybe Dust Animus as well. And then maybe trim Jace on the draw. Maybe a Wandering Emperor can be a little slow. Maybe trim a Lockdown or a Depauplate, something like that. Maybe even a Deduce on the draw might be okay. Yeah, that's for the blue-white part. So let's play. You can see I was playing the Teemer Ram deck. Pretty high on the ladder. I had a really good run yesterday on stream. I'll show you real quick. I'll brag. That's the on-tap profile. That was yesterday. It was a Teemer Ram play, which I was somewhat locked onto blue-white, but then I had that crazy run was Teemer Ramp of 11 and 0. You can see blue-white control though, pretty solid. 77% win rate was that list. And then before that, 84%, really, really large sample. So I did not play too many of the tough matchups with Teemer Ramp. I beat blue-black mid-range once or twice, which is tough. I didn't get paired against control though. I didn't get paired against the four-color Legends deck, which I think is a tough matchup as well. So, you know, Arena Ladder, always take it, was a grain of salt for sure. All right, on the draw, obviously missing some lands, but I think it was No More Lies. If I didn't have No More Lies or Deduce, I would probably just mulligan this hand. Against Rust Convoke, pretty solid start. It's not quite the turn to Knight, but. And they're topping. I would consider Boros Convoke to be a fine matchup for blue-white. I don't think blue-white has any really terrible matchups. Maybe like the super hateful versions of the black-green mid-range decks was Lust of Lilies, Investigators, Cavern of Souls, the rest main deck Bronco. It was funny where some of my teammates played black-green and I was playing the matchup and it was pretty easy. At first, because it was bad, there was like one Duress in the main, maybe one Lily, no Broncos, and now the lists are like three or four Duress main, three or four Bronco, which is really threatening. All right, let's see. Don't want to get rid of the Warden and give them tons of resources. I think I just need to draw some cards, maybe counter an Anthem here. All right, land secured. Now I need to live. Don't take too much damage either because it can just finish me off with Myrex. Right. I think I'm okay, honestly, taking five here. That pumped the Warden somewhere, I would have considered Gelos, but not gonna be greedy. I'm gonna use the draw to discard one mode of three steps ahead here. Jeez. Okay. And now I have a decision. I'm going to let that resolve and then use Get Lost on the Warden, I think. Because I don't want to go down to two. I didn't want to counter that and die to a Recruiter Eater. I'm still in a really bad spot, but... Fully 5 life is manageable. He should just sag the maps here. And I am dead on board to just Myrex token plus recruiter. But this is not the same either. Fancy. Gleeful into Recruiter. Just Recruiter was enough. Just flexing on me. Yeah, on the draw, that's how I started. I didn't have Lockdown. Even turn for the power play would have been nice. So in this matchup, both Tidebinders, Elesh Norn, Boonbringer. I do not bring in Knockout Blow or Flanker. I bring in the two Lockdowns. Board out most of the deduce, the chase. I think I board out Farewell. Elesh Narn kind of deals with the Anthem. Farewell's a little expensive. Keep in one deduce just to make some land drops. I think this is pretty reasonable. You could maybe do two deduce, two deluge. I don't hate that either. Make your early game a little more consistent. I have brought in Flanker and Knock Elbow in this matchup. I think if I had to pick one, I would bring in the first Knock Elbow before the first Flanker, but I don't think you need them. Alright, good hands. So would I be happier with the Dust Animus here or Boonbringer? I'm clear, it's kind of nice that I get to deduce. I did draw the non-blow of deduce and lockdown, but a lot of times you can afford to just deduce, sag the clue, or sag the, yeah, the clue, and then just play Lockdown on 4. They have a slower draw, so it's not too bad for me. I don't think there's a rush to Lockdown. I'd rather get my extra cards. Keep in mind they can have Get Lost for Lockdown. Some of their annoying cards after sideboard are Thalia, Invasion of Gobekan as well. Let's see. Nice synergy here. I drew a creature, I drew a Tidebinder, so I can get value out of the backup. I'll just Let them have that. My line's probably going to be field over in a land, get a plains, untap, have mana for lockdown plus normalize. Seems very nice. I should have maybe just field over on my turn. You're worried about Wandering Emperor, but there's just not much you can do about it. Just have to hope I don't have it. Oh, it has vigilance, right? Stupid. I had a feeling I was seeing something dumb. Myrick's kind of nice. I actually get the whole value out of my field over. Hopefully they make a token. Feel like they should expect a sweeper. Like I'm gonna have depopulate mana, lockdown mana, Sunfall mana. Pretty a little greedy to make a Myrex. I didn't float either. I think they would float Sag the Clue. Right, deserted beach. Probably counter almost any play to make, even just an Epicure. Nothing. Okay. What do you have? Just all lands? This game's just super over. Even Interrupter. Okay. Not sure that's the best play, but also I don't think it really matters. Yeah. Even just Anchorage almost is too much. Alright, on the draw, I'll cut the deuce. I'll do a knockout blow. And I want to do a flanker. A deluge. Maybe a deluge. Could keep in one deuce. The idea is that you have an extra draw step, so you're a little more likely to make your land drops without the deuce. Could be better, obviously. I could have a two, but as long as they don't have perfect hands, ooh. Kind of giving a bit my hand away there. Also, that's bad. I did that because of the Gleeful Demolition lines, but feels like it's kind of giving my hand away, plus the timing fell, and now I get to have to play Anchorage now. I think that was maybe bad. Like when they go turn one Warden, it's less likely they have the crazy knotted hand. Yeah. I could have at least forged one of the Wardens here. I'm like kind of off tempo. Does lose, does really lose. I'd feel much better if I'd, yeah, just Anchorage Shenhua, get to March 1 of War Ordinance. Then we're just gonna go ahead and try to get the forge. This is sorcery too, so they're in their combat stat, they can't pump and attack. No land. Can main phase 3 steps ahead. It's close. Sidebinder just buys me so much time. I think I'm just gonna say go. Well, that is not what I wanted to do. That's pretty impressive, misclicking twice there. Just gonna Tidebinder one of the wardens if that's what they do. Lot of mistakes were made this game. Maybe that attack was good. I could just Wraith, honestly. I do have like just triple Tidebinder and a March. In hindsight, I wish I'd just used my March with Sunfall. This one? Does slow them down, shuts up that one. They can knight, but only for 1 mana creatures. If they play a bunch of permanents and pump the warden, I can just exile it with my march. If they put too many resources in one of the wardens. Weird game. Like they're all flooded. Never mind. Yeah, did not play the best, that is for sure. The plan is to either Tidebinder something scary or just march the warden and knock out Wilder Recruiter. Bottom. I have 1 card left. They march the warden in response. It's pretty bad if their last card is good. I guess I'll let them have one more scry. At 8, okay, I think I'm better off just seeing go again. Much. Woo. Very much better than Dust Animus this game. Yeah, they flooded a bit, which was lucky, but also that whole sequence saying like keeping white man on turn one, that was so bad. They do get their forge back. Can even copy Boonbringer next turn. That's cool, I've never done that before. Probably gonna do that. Or I could just hold a counter, I guess. It is pretty tempting. That's the worst that can happen. I mean, the worst if they could have a Gelos in response. I mean, they would have Gelos on their turn, right? 100%. All right. I cannot resist. It's almost lethal. Even recruiters, not nearly enough. Right, close. We need the sweeper. Who needs a sweeper? All right, sweepers aren't nice in this matchup, but right, so that was blue-white control in action. Other deck I'm considering is the Teemer Anissa deck. It was arguably the best deck before the new set. Then people got a little worried about Rest in Peace. And, you know, Rest in Peace is good, but it's beatable and people can't just have a million in their sideboard either. The decks that play Rest in Peace, you know, in Blue Light Control, for instance, there's, you know, they have their own Memory Deluge. It's not all upside. But yeah, I would say this is a fairly stock list. And by the way, if you enjoyed the content, make sure to, you know, follow the channel, subscribe, like, leave a comment, let me know. Maybe you have a big standard tournament coming up. What's your deck of choice? Or if you have your own RC, what are you considering? If you've played one of these two decks, you know, do you agree with most of what I said, or do you have different card choices? Just let me know and I'll try to answer. But yeah, you know, I would say this is pretty close to a stock main deck. I guess I should go over what the deck does first. Maybe some of you are new to standard. So this is a weird one. You're basically trying to abuse Nissa, which triggers when you have two lands that come into play in one turn. So you're playing these weird fetch lands from whatever set they're from. And the only cards you can hit is another Nissa or the Analyst. The Analyst mills you, and you can sack it to bring back lands. So you're trying to self-mill lands, sack the Analyst. That's why you play a lot of fetch lands. They gain you life in the process, which is huge. If these cards said the same thing, was that you gain one life, this deck would probably not even be playable. The aggro matchups would be so much worse that it would probably not be, one of the best decks in the format. Definitely not tier one, in my opinion. So yeah, that's kind of the engine. Once you have a lot of mana, you're trying to cast huge fireballs, either with your lands or, at some point you can cast the Virtue of Strength. That card fits in the deck really nicely. For one green, you can get back one of your key creatures or one of the fetch lands. And then later in the game, it's just tons of mana. You play it, you untap, you have 20 plus mana, you can fireball them. You're also ramping with Spelunking, which ramps you, makes the lands you fetch come into play untap, nice little mana boost. You've got Deluge as your engine. You can self-mill it with Analyst. Even in some of the aggressive matchups, Deluge can come in handy. Ill-Time Explosion is really good in this deck. It's your sweeper plus card advantage, so it's never dead. You have 7 mana cards in your deck, so you can even get rid of Shield Reds, maybe even Elesh Norn after sideboard. So, super good card. The one Shigeki is pretty important to the main. It's your late game insurance to get back your fireballs so you don't just die to someone who can just counter your free fireballs. You can also get back the Shigeki with the 1 mana part of the Virtue, which comes up. And it's just a good card on turn two. A lot of time you're on the play on turn two, they have to kill it or else you get a massive advantage. To round out the deck, you have some removal. Fires of Victory is usually the one people play. I also like Volcanic Spite. You can play Vampire's Vengeance, that's in the sideboard. You could play some of that card in the main deck. And then there's the one Kellen, which fits nicely in the deck. It ramps you on turn two. It's a frat, it can kill Hearse after sideboard. Just fits nicely in the deck. It gives you the nut hand of turn two ramp, turn three Nissa into fetch land. And just a solid card to round out the deck. I would say the cards you could consider are a Force Rage. You could play more Fires of Victory over Spite. You could play more or less Spelunkings. You could play more or less Kellen, between 0 and 2, between 2 and 4 Spelunking. Same for Green Virtue, between 2 and 4. I think 30 lands is good. It's a minimum. I would think I'd rather play 31 than 29 if I had to pick, but 30 seems good. What else? Some people play the Colossal Skyndrill, the blue-green 7 mana card that can bounce a creature or get back a card from your graveyard. I think that card is just kind of mediocre. The rate is not great. It's not essential to your combo. I've never had a problem game one running out of win cons between Shigeki and getting back Shigeki with Virtue. It would really take a freak draw for it to matter. Even though the loop was Turtle and Shigeki is insane value in the late game, that's not really been my experience that you needed. I could be wrong. Maybe it's because I never played with a Turtle, so I never realized how good it is, but this Turtle strikes me as a card that the rate's not that great and not essential. And then there's the mana base. I think 13 or 14 fetch lands is good, between 12 and 14. The basics, I used to play 6 forests, 6 islands, 5 mountains, but people have pointed out that you don't need so many mountains. Some people even go down to 3 mountains. I like at least 4 because it gives me 13 sources of red, which I think is needed for turn 2 red removal. If you're going to play the cheap red removal, I think you want 13 sources, just solid deck building. Same for Rage. A lot of time you'd cast Rage on turn 3 for 1, typically killing a bat. With Rage for 1 is a really solid play. You usually get a land back from your graveyard, your ramp, kill their bat. It's card advantage too, because we're getting back the land from your graveyard, not from your hand. So yeah. And then the Bossage I've not played with much, but people have said it's good. You do need like a lot of basics. It does come up that fetching the extra basics matters. So I'm not super sure it's worth it, but it is nice that you can use it to get one of the permanents, and then when you use Aftermath, it comes back into play. So it kind of makes sense. So yeah, I think main deck's pretty stuck. You could do some variation. Some people, you could start playing the creatures in the main, but I think you want to streamline your game one game plan as much as possible. You don't need to do anything crazy. Your main plan works against most people. Sideboard is where it becomes pretty interesting with this deck. You see like 14 different cards, I think. Essence Scatter, I'm gonna go over them individually, I guess. Essence Scatter is for Elesh Norn, Rafine, maybe Gix. This one is sketchy. People, almost no one plays Essence Scatter, so this one's kind of experimental. The One Hermit is nice against control. I think it's nice against the black decks because it's okay against Lily. It gives you fodder to sack, or if you discard it, it gives you a body on the way back. Having it into play means that they can't just have go for the throat mana for your Nissa, so you can protect it. So I think the utility is kind of nice. A Braid is kind of your anti-hearse package. It's versatile. It can kill a hearse, but also kill a Gix. Especially if you don't know what your opponent is up to, you don't want something too narrow, but Braid is nice. Hearse is mostly for the mirror. Mei should be a second Frillback. Frillback is nice because in the mirror it kills Virtue. A lot of the games comes back to like trading resources, and then someone plays a Virtue on taps, plays a Fireball, so Frillback kills a Virtue. Exiling Graveyard is obviously huge, so I'm not too sure about the hearse, but as I said, I haven't played this much as Blue White, even though I did play it a lot before the new sets. Vamp's Vengeance, mostly against Convoke, also good against Mono Red. That used to be a main deck card, and if you expect a lot of red and Convoke, you could definitely play that in the main deck over maybe a third Spelunking or one of the Splash removals. Totally acceptable. You can tell I think it's good because it's the only card I have more than a one of in my entire sideboard. Frillback, pretty versatile, good in the mirror, good against mono red. I think it's okay against Boros Convoke, but I'm not sure. I've heard it's a trap. It's a nice speed bump. It can get rid of the invasion of Gobekan once it's flipped. Pick Your Poison, nice versatile, deals with hearse, Rafine, bat. I've even been told to maybe bring it in against Convoke, which makes sense because they can have the invasion. Also, one of the ways you lose to Convoke is the Warden. Sometimes they just get the Warden out of control and you can't even kill it with ill time anymore. So your poison can kill the Warden once it has three counters or more. You can bring it in against control for Rest in Peace. As I said, if they play Rest in Peace and then you get rid of it with Pick Your Poison, the damage is kind of done. They don't really have a ton of flyers. It is nice because if you don't know if they have Rest in Peace or Hearse or something else, it's kind of flexible. Negates mostly for control for the mirror. Tidebinder. Good in the mirror, good against control, good against Convoke, just pretty flexible. And, I like that card. Most lists don't play it. Maybe you don't need it. Baylos, same as in Blue White against the Lily decks. It's nice that this deck can actually cast it, so you can bring it against Mono Red. I would maybe consider having a second one. Just because it's nice against Red, and I think it's going to be pretty high impacts against the Lily Investigator decks. Roxane has been really solid for me. There's a lot of matchups where you just bring in the Roxane, bring in Bonipal, sometimes bring in Titan, and it kind of helps you beat the haste. The hate, what can happen in sideboard games is that people are too reactive and too much hate. Their draws can be mopey, and then you just ramp into a Roxane and kind of takes over, gets you a ton of value. Cards, the Wraith is just really good on this card, so it's a really good card. You could just have one Roxane and one Bonipal in the main and maybe be fine. But yeah, that's kind of the package. Titan, note that Titan is a little trickier. You can hit Titan, it's an elemental. So you can hit it of Nissa, which can be good and can also be bad because sometimes all you want is Annalis and you hit the Titan and it loses you the game. So that one's kind of tricky for me. I haven't quite figured out how essential it is and if you actually want it. But yeah, for instance, against Convoke, I have been bringing in Roxane and Bonnie Paul. In case they bring in too many cards like Rest in Peace or the Flanker or maybe Surge of Salvation, and they have these like slower draws because they have these reactive cards stuck in your hand, and you just kind of ignore it and just ramp into these kind of cards, and they're just fine to draw, and they've been good for me. And then last card you can't see is Doppelgang. It's the triple X card that copies permanents. That's also a card you bring in against a deck like blue-black control that can have deadly cover-up for some of your win conditions. You kind of diversify your win conditions. It's a late-game threat, and it is unclear how many of these cards you want. Elesh Norn is also an issue. So, Elesh Norn kind of counters all your creatures, but doesn't work against Doppelgang. Even though they drop in an early Elesh Norn, it's much harder to ramp because your lands don't do anything anymore. Your, bringing back the lands doesn't work. Nissa doesn't work. So it can be hard to get to enough mana to make these cards relevant. So a lot of the time what I will do is I will trim the graveyard stuff because they're bringing in graveyard hate. So I'll trim maybe a Rage. I'll trim maybe a Virtue of Strength or two, maybe a Spelunking, the spot removal if you don't think they're good in the matchup. I'll maybe trim Shigeki on the draw against someone that has like cut downs and go for the throats. I have trimmed one Analyst, one Nissa in some matchups, even though I do feel like it's kind of quote unquote your best cards, and I like the idea of making them have it. But yeah, you'll trim these cards against the super aggro matchups. You can go down to one or two Deluge. But even against Red and Convoke, I like keeping one or two Deluge. You do need some expensive cards to start to L-time Explosion sometimes. And you have all these spot removal, these cards that buy you time. And sometimes you can flood a bit because you're boarding out a lot of your value cards. You still want some. So yeah, sideboarding is pretty cool with this deck. Trimming's usually a good strategy. And yeah, just fun deck, really powerful deck. Obviously, I'm considering for the RC. Yeah, it's kind of fun too. It's pretty unique. It's the good side of having these huge standards, these 3-year rotation standards, was I believe it's 12 sets now, mean that you get. Once in a while you get a weird deck like that pops up that would not be possible if you don't have. I think the fetch lands are rotating next this summer. So obviously the deck would be unplayable without the fetch lands. There's Evolving Wilds and stuff, but the life gain is just too important. So yeah. All right, interesting hand. No green mana, no third land. And the hand's not even that amazing. Non-tap land, so I think this is a mulligan. This is a bit better. Just get rid of one of the ill times. I do have turn two fires if I'm against something aggressive. Black green looks like. Let's get some green mana. One thing I didn't talk about is the Kellen is really nice. But there's a little tension. The one that side of Kellen is there a little tension was the red removal spell, meaning the 2 mana part of Kellen is, let's see, how do I want to sequence that? If they have turned to Glissar Preacher, I'd rather go mountain. But if they don't do anything next turn, I'd rather be able to play Spelunking, so. I'm not sure, honestly. Yeah, you'll have the tension of, do you want red mana on turn one, but then you can't ramp with Skellen, or vice versa. Trespasser. Trespasser is a pain. Alright, let them have another Trespasser trigger. And then just sweep the boards. Next turn. Oh, Stomper. That's the list. I think it plays the 6/5. I forget what's it called, the legendary 6/5. Kind of close. I do have fire, so I don't think I need ill time. Just a basic. Our land's going to play on tap anyways. And get a second island. Other trespass there. How many lands I have left? One? Good enough. I'd have also go make them target the lands. Was a trespasser ability. They might just target one of their creatures. Think this game's going in the right direction for me. Kind of weathering the storm. Pillage the Bog for 12. What's the absolute best card they can find in this matchup? Not sure. Investigator could be annoying. Lily could be a little annoying. Main deck hearse. Jeez. All right, I guess I'm sacking the analyst now. All right, they come in play on tap. I'm actually one short of just casting. Oh no, never mind. It was like way too little green mana. Or blue mana. I'll take the hits. I will take a hit. Six, nine. Let's see. I main phase Deluge? 6/9, I have 10 mana. Good Fires of Victory, but then they can kill their own Trespasser. I don't get to draw the cards. Good Deluge, try and find a Nissa, it's probably gonna die to a removal spell. All right. No. Let's see, go. No, I'm not. Yes, I am. Oh no, because it flips. Okay. Right. I made up my mind. I'm sure. I'm gonna do that. Gonna discard a mountain, but I'm also gonna draw a card. I actually drew the second source of blue. So now I might wait. I might wait till my next turn to double deluge without them being able to remove it with the hearse. We'll see how much pressure they apply. One thing I could do also is deluge end of their turn. And then they're gonna feel like they need to remove it, which unlocks my green virtue potentially. Probably what I have to do now that they've played Investigator. They're gonna exile it. I can Virtue Analyst, play Nissa. One for Virtue, three for Nissa, and then six for Analyst. Exactly 10. And if they don't exile, I mean, I get to flashback a Deluge, which is also huge. But they might just. Gonna exile the Deluge and the Analyst. Oh no, they went for a land. I drew the Analyst anyways. Huh. All right, what's the sequencing here? Do I have the mana just hard cast? Get back Analyst, hard cast Virtue. So that's eight. Ten, eight, tap six, play one of the analysts. Get back at least mana, but if I don't have green mana, I'm screwed. All right, I think I'm gonna play analyst first, see what I mill. Mill the Shigeki and mill a Deluge. That's nice. I'm playing this, it would have been nice to mill some lands. Put some green. Some blue. Not Renissa, not the greatest. In Virtue Shigeki is nice, but what else am I gonna do? I do have hearse. Could just Shigeki Deluge. Now just play it safe. Oh, I guess I lost the mana. All right. Cool game. I have the feeling they might get me. Depends what they have left. Four, seven, eight, 12. So I can play Virtue. And then have 15 mana. Feel like I should be okay. We kind of. Let's take it here. This doesn't do anything. That's huge. So I should do it first because I want to cast Virtue of the Nissa mana. So I have more lands untapped. Right. I mean, that's just about not timing out really at this point. Think. Two lands, very welcome. All right. I just cast it a little. I'm not too sure here, but Rage and play the land. I guess Besiegement is nice. How much mana is that, by the way? 12, 16. So I can get rid of the Hurst. Huh. Okay. Some extra land in my yard. I could maybe just play to the board here. Maybe even Deluge first. Just L-timed. How many L-times I have left? None. Never mind. Yeah, the next fireball is going to be lethal, so I'm going to just. Get rid of the Glissa, I guess. Back to lands. This only basics. Well, maybe I had enough mana to like Rage Gem and Rage Gem again with Shigeki. Right, I'm gonna Shigeki Rage, Hill Time, and Hell Time maybe. And then. Yeah, I maybe got a little lost in the sauce, as they say here. Discarded L-Time and Nissa. Their boards. And Virtue Shigeki while I can. And I'm just gonna play the Nissa. And then next turn I can Virtue Fireball. So they need like, I don't even know, double Investigator, I guess. I mean, I should have kept Shigeki than the rest. It's kind of loose. Okay, so very double virtue is like triples the mana, or it's like three times free, so. All right, we got there. And that was like into like Trespasser, Hearse, Investigator, all that stuff. All right, so. So. A braid, yes. Pick your poison, no. Frillback, no. Baloth, absolutely. And then I think you won the creatures. Tidebinder, maybe. Hermit. Seems fine, even blocks Bronco. All right, now for the trims. Virtue, even though it won me the game. Gonna trim at least one. Gonna trim a rage. Gonna trim fires. Gonna trim a spelunking. Gonna trim the Shigeki. And then I'm gonna trim one of each creature and see if that feels good. So it's kind of what I was talking about in the deck tech, just trim a bit of everything. All your main deck cards get a little worse. No green mana, but kind of just hand scoops to like turn two Hearse. So none of my cards do anything anymore. That's a little scary. I guess I'm all. Cool. Apple Gang, way too expensive. Titan, same. Keep Virtue, hope they don't have to turn to Hearse. Of a choice here. Rip, rip, rip. Still gonna play the fetch land, I guess. Keep my untapped lands if I top deck, something good. Kind of questionable. Yeah, I usually go down to one virtue. It was so good for me in game one, and insta punish. And this I would have maybe been a bit better. And maybe an analyst. Yeah, now they have an engine. Kind of just have to play it and hope they have super awkward hands. I mean, mull to 5, my hand's not panning out at all. It's fine. I'll get them in game three. Also, the Virtue are just better on the play because even if they have turn to Hearse, you do have time to go fetch into Virtue. And since you're on the draw, you don't need them. The land drop as bad. Sometimes Virtue just good because you need that extra land drop. Okay. Nice analyst I've got here. I mean, this is going to be nearly enough, but yeah. We shall see. Can one Bonnie Paul really carry me? Could almost jump here. Yeah. Have to do it now. It doesn't target. Should I save it? Should I put it into play? Gonna lose both my cards anyways. I'll just put it into play. And just get forest in case I draw a Titan of Industry. Under attacking with hers. Like, why did I not have to discard? But it's a raid I did with from my hand to the graveyard that I didn't realize. Real back. Okay. Not sure what I'm hoping for, but Rage Seiju. Seiju, get back with Seiju. Fight the Gliss. I mean, I'm still just dead to guess there's Reach. Bonnie Paul has Reach. Need to get a Bass. I'm at four. You have six cards in hand. Yeah, that's cottage and stuff. Oh, wait a minute. Way too many creatures. Okay. All right. Well, the virtues do get better on the play, so maybe I want to keep them in. Steinbinder does deal with Hearse most of their threats. These decks usually ca have Cavern of Souls too. Like Negate could be okay. A lot of this stuff could be okay. Let's see. I kind of like the balance of what I have here, though. I think this is pretty reasonable. And then we'd keep in two virtues. I mean, this draw they had what they needed, and I still like that was me mulling to five. Right, great hands. Are really good hands. They don't have turn one to rest, I get to go Velen into Virtual Lands. It's just such a massive boost. It's like insane setup for the late game. If they play Hearse, I get to play Kellen and Fred on the Hearse. So now they need to have, can have Lily minus, or just a removal spell, but at least it takes their turn. Stomper, that thing that doesn't have reach can't even block. Oh. My little hearse. Let's see. If I'll just Virtue again. Actually, I messed up. I'm sad. I forgot Bonnie Paul was double blue. My whole hand is double blue, I guess. That's one way to win. I should have sagged the clue first in case I draw a blue fetch land. They could win if they have the 6/5. Whatever it's called, I forget the name. The legend combo. Yeah, I would have drawn the theater too. Whoops. Whoopsie. That's really bad. Ooh, Kellen even negates, a bit of the investigator value. It's pretty nice. Probably just play Bonnie Paul next turn. Virtue is bad against Frillback and Tear Asunder. Deluge is like too OP. Maybe I'll see go. They have mana up. Let's see, they're getting rid of my douche. Probably still play Bonnie Paul even in dev, go for the Fred that are tapping out. Nice. Nice, nice, nice. I get value too. Draw. Back land from the yard. Two massive creatures. Lily. All right, and Kellen even gets to block. Forgot Kellen had
And you
vigilance
think you
too.
can win? Off you
They're at
go.
11? I just sag bow. Just because of the vigilance. But Bowie's almost lethal. mean, it kind of is lethal as analyst. And I guess it's a better blocker to have go for the for Bonnie Paul. I still have an 8-8 and they don't have great attacks. All right, so can play a land. Have no cards left. Nine, play a land, play a virtue, play analyst, sack analyst. Bow at least be 11-11. So I'd have to start chomping. It's just great setup for future turns. And I guess I could get unlucky and mill zero lands. Good beats. Okay. That's a good draw. Now I get to Fires with Kicker, or Fires plus Deluge, or Fires plus Hermit, whichever I want. Me just Fires plus Hermit. Don't think it really matters. Oh, right, I don't have enough cards in hand. All right, let's Deluge. And when killing is good, it's so good. That's just so obscene. Yep.
I'm tired of your secrets.
Get rid of my deluge at least. I've got another one. Yeah. All right, let's have some fun. OBM Virtue. I guess I will let them know they're in trouble. Four. Destroy that thing. That's a deluge. Okay. All right, well, glad I could pad a bit my win rates with these two wins. Yeah, there you have it, blue-white control and the Team Rolands deck. Team Rolands deck definitely feels like more powerful, more broken, but blue-white control is kind of solid across the boards. I've also never played the Team Rolands deck in paper. So, not sure how good my mechanist will be, but these are the two decks I'm considering. And yeah, details of the list and stuff. So, as always, if you made it this far and you haven't done so yet, consider subscribing to the channel, liking the video, leaving a comment. That's the YouTube channel. There's also my Twitch. I stream every day on Twitch, or almost every day on Twitch, twitch.tv/yellowhat. You can also help us out by following Ultimate Guard on social media, on Twitter, Ultimate Guard Live on Twitch. Lots of cool stuff. They're always bringing you new products, deck boxes, sleeves, all that good stuff. If you're looking for high quality sleeves, high quality deck boxes, and you want to support that kind of content. But yeah, if you made it this far, thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you all next time. Take care.